Hi guys, and welcome to the cash flow template. So this is going to be a difficult one. Tracking your cash flow is super important whenever you're running your business, and this template is supposed to help you doing this. Now, that being said, cash flow is of course a very complex topic, and I've tried my best to make this as easy as possible, but you need to wrap your head around it. But this is what this video is for. So I'm going to walk you through every single step that you need to take in order to make sure that in the future, you can easily plan your cash flows using this template, coming from accounts receivable and accounts payable. So let's first take a look at the number of sheets that we have. In total, we have 5 support sheets, always marked in a light green. And we got 2 main analysis sheets, accounts receivable and accounts payable. So let's first spend a minute on the mapping. The mapping is actually quite big if you compare it to other templates, in case you've downloaded some of them. Now again, we've got the familiar year and month. We're also seeing a conversion factor in case you're working with very large numbers and you want to show them in thousands. Then we have products and raw materials. We got customers, the payment terms. So when do they need to pay us? We invoice them, and then 30, 45, or 60 days later, they of course need to pay us. And at the same time, we also have vendors, meaning that we procure from them and we have to pay them. Again, with a couple of payment terms here. Now, F until I are quite generic, as are D and E, to be honest. But what you want to make sure is whenever you bring in your customers, first, give them the right name and also assign the right payment terms, because this is going to be super important, as you will see in just a minute. The same, of course, holds true for vendor and payment terms. Now, this is exactly the same, just applying to accounts payable. So now let's take a look at the next support sheet, which is sales data. Now, sales data is essentially how much we've sold to which customer, in which period, in which year. There's nothing more to say. And of course, you want to make sure that the green cells reflect your actual sales, and they're also in line with the data you're seeing right here. Please do me a favor, do not change the order. Why? Because we're using named ranges for the year, the period, the product, customer, and sales. And if you fiddle around with that order, you'll see that later on the formulas won't work as nicely. Now again, that being said, this is the template that has a customization level of 3, meaning that it's quite complex. And you need to put in some time to really make this work for you. So once we've done this and we got all the data set, we can actually analyze our sales. So let's go over here to the sales sheet. What do you see here? Essentially, you see the product that we've sold. You can, of course, change. I mean, these are drop-down lists, all referring to the mapping table. And you can select any kind of product that you want to analyze. You can also change the customer. And depending on the customer, the payment terms will update automatically. You see that for accessories, we didn't have any sales in Jan, but we had some in Feb, some in March, and so on and so forth. And depending on your selections here, this will of course change every single time. What does the top row indicate? Well, this one is just giving you the total sales. It's a subtotal that's calculated essentially. What do you do if you need additional space? If you have additional products, if you have additional customers, and so on and so forth. As always, I encourage you, use the rows in between tables. So you can just easily go ahead, input like 3 additional rows. You can drag down all of this, because these are just formulas. And so let's do that quickly. And you see, your total range over here is adjusting. Taken into consideration these additional 3 rows as well. And you essentially have 3 more categories to choose from. Okay. So now once we've sorted out the mapping, the sales data, and the sales as such, we can actually look at the cash flow. Now accounts receivable, what are they indicating us? They're saying that depending on the payment terms that we have, meaning 30 days, 45 days, 60 days, and so on and so forth. Now again, make sure that this ties in with this, because you know you want to track this data essentially, right? So depending on that, let's say we have a sale in Jan for 1.3 million. I'm just referring to this data tab right here. Now this means that within 30 days, we will still be collecting that. Now the cash flow analysis as it is constructed here will show you that it's going to be collected right here. So essentially you inflate your accounts receivable balance in Jan, but you're also collecting that money. So what's going to be your net cash flow impact for the month? It's going to be zero because these are offsetting each other. What about the 60 days? So here we have a sale for 24.1 million, but we have payment terms of 60 days. So the customer essentially has 60 days before he has to pay us. Now this will be collected in February, you see? So when you make changes, first of all, this is all coming automatically, right? You see the formulas are constructed in a way so that they can only pick up whatever days you've selected here. Now, of course, making sure that this ties in with the general mapping data you've defined over here. But what you need to make sure then is that these formulas are still making sense. Let's say if you don't have any customer that has 30 days of payment terms, you shouldn't be looking at it like this, right? You should make adjustments to these formulas. So change the white ones, but do not change the green ones, because these are just going to be the total sum of those, which will then translate into your chart down here called net account movement. So what does it mean if our net movement for the month of Jan 2019 is 119.4 positive? That actually means that we've, on the bottom line, we've increased our receivables balance by 119.4 million. Now, if you're familiar with the cash flow concept, you will know that increases in the accounts receivable balance are actually a bad thing because they are a negative cash flow. You've sold it, yes, but you haven't collected the money. That's the key piece of cash flow. Only when you collect the money, you actually have a cash inflow. So for the month of Jan, while we've sold quite a bit, we're collecting only 7.1, so that the net movement for the month is 119 positive. So much for the accounts receivable. Let's move on to the accounts payable. First of all, we have a similar setup as with the sales data, but in this case, it's invoice data. So we are procuring raw materials from different vendors who are giving us a purchase price, and essentially we update this data as we see fit. Now, when we need to see what we're actually procuring, we can have the exact same view as we had with the sales, but now for invoices. And again, this will just pick up whatever month and whatever raw material or vendor selection you have selected. Now note that the payment terms again will just update according to the vendor selection right here. And then in the end, what you want to analyze are your accounts payable and the net movements, of course. So we have the exact same view as with the accounts receivable, but this time, guys, the concept is different. So if you are procuring a lot, your vendors are going to give you an invoice. That invoice will say, look, your payment terms are 30 days, 45 days, 60 days, and so on and so forth. So are you actually paying for that 17.9 million that you've accrued for in January? Yes, you are, because payment terms are 30 days. And now our model works that way, that it actually takes into consideration those 30 days and thinks, hey, we're paying it in the same month. But with the 60 days one, you're not going to pay in Jan directly, because you're going to pay in Feb, because it takes 2 months to complete it, essentially, right? Now, of course, a flaw of this model is, I'm completely with you, is now you could say, yeah, but it depends on when we actually sold it, right? If we sold it, or if we procured it on the 1st of January, then yes, we would essentially have to pay for it on the 31st. And at the same time, if we only procured it on the 29th, then this wouldn't work as nicely. I'm with you guys, right? Now, of course, this is not to be taken as the source of truth for cash flow. Of course, you have your bookings and you should always refer to the actual invoices that are paid, but this is a great tool to help you plan your cash flow as we project it into the 24-month future. So that being said, with cash flow and accounts payable, the concept is different. Because as I said before, yes, we have sourced materials that are worth in total 32.8 million, but we're only paying 20.8. So the net movement is actually 12 million. We have a cash inflow, so to speak, because we got a service, but we haven't paid for it yet, of 32.8 million, but we've only paid for 20.8. So that means our net inflow or net movement on the accounts payable is 12 million for the month. And that is it for the cash flow template. Again, this is a very complex one. You need to invest some time to make sure that this really suits your needs. But I guarantee you, it's going to be a super helpful tool when it comes to analyzing and, most importantly, planning your cash flows. Because remember, cash is king.